Oh yeah, and that Simitar, by the way, that really needs a buff, because I mean, seriously, that turn rate.
Dude, are you kidding me?
That turn rate.
Dude, just cloak. Come on, man. Okay,
it's you're supposed to be turning faster than that.
No, you're not.
It's a tactical ship. You turn faster.
Did you see the movie? Ship. Okay, it works just like the movie. It had the secondary shields, just like
no,
in the movie.
No,
yeah,
it
does.
The turn rate in the movie was seriously much faster.
Wow, I mean, it's cloaked. Because it was cloaked in the movie.
Even
the
when
time.
It wasn't cloaked, it was moving pretty quickly, you know.
No, it wasn't. They were getting rammed by Deanna Troi. Just saying. To Foundry Files, it's the ultimate Foundry Files podcast. It's about a tool set that maybe none of you have heard of, but a few of you have. It makes Foundry missions. So, like, if you liked writing for Star Trek, though, like, maybe you didn't. I don't know. Wait, what's going on? Anyway, whatever this show's about, it's about the Foundry, and there's nothing going on with the Foundry again. But that's okay. Because it's at least buggy and broken still.
It's still a bit buggy. And yeah. I mean, I've tried a couple of times over the weekend to get in, and it failed.
Yeah.
So
I was really upset. I was going to make a Cleon mission for the first time ever, because, you know, the Cleons need some content over there, at least some story content. So I was like, what the heck? I got an idea for a story. It's not going to work on the Fed side. I'll go make it on the Cleon side. I go to make it. I start making the maps, and crash. I'm out. And I can't get back into that project for whatever reason, from the same bug that Wee said he was having, where it's just you get you just crash out of the game when you try to load up a project and error.
Yeah, I actually tried to go into the Foundry, and just as normal, let it load, all that kind of stuff. I went away for all kind of stuff. You know, you go away from game, like it's taking really long. You just go away for a few minutes, that kind of thing, and you come back and it says login failed for another reason, and I'm back at the login screen again.
Yeah.
I'm like, that doesn't help.
No, it doesn't. And I haven't tried to get into any of my other projects, just the one I was working on, because those projects have been done for like a year. If they're broken, I'll read about it in a review and check it out. I mean, I checked a few of them out that I knew were broken, and they're fixed now, so I assume any other ones have been fixed. But I'll have to check reviews. But I really wanted to work on this new mission, and it's, no, I can't. Which, Cryptic, please fix it. Please. I mean, it's great that the Foundry editor is back up, and that's why we brought the show back. But if Foundry authors can't get into it because it crashes them out all the time, that's not good. So please, just go give the Foundry a tummy rub. Say, it's okay. It's okay. Just start working again. And then we'll all be happy. A few Foundry authors have managed to get in, because I know a few authors have made some new missions that are up. So some are getting in, but we're right now not.
Yeah. So. In other news, the Scimitar came out.
Yay! We like the Scimitar.
I really like the Scimitar. I mean,
ignore the joke at the beginning.
We like.
I'm
a big fan
it.
Of the Fleet Hawkeye, which is the Fleet Vulture. Fantastic Klingon battlecruiser that is. Absolutely worthwhile ship. It basically takes up all of my time, and now the Scimitar is really taking up arms against it. And I'm actually competing which one's my favorite now, because the Scimitar. I mean, despite the low turn rate, it's just a fantastic ship. It really is.
Dude, Scimitar all the way. That ship has looked badass. The Vorcha just looks retarded. I mean, I always hate the look of the Vorcha. And the Scimitar is
change. I mean, I've got the Volcang, which
it's
kind of looks
still
pretty
stupid.
Skinny.
Still
and I've got the talk out the fleet version of it as well. That's pretty good, I have to admit.
No, Scimitar is awesome. It can launch shuttles. It can Thaleron, Firewall Cloaked. It has all this stuff. What's the Vorcha got? Ooh, I can just take some hits. No, but seriously, I have not spent money on this game since free-to-play launch, and even at that point, I hadn't spent money in a few months. This was the first time I actually found myself. I went to the grocery store. I picked up some Ultimate Game cards. Now, of course, you know that there is a sale going on for the Ultimate Game cards, so you think, oh, great, you're getting extra points for that. I bought these the day before that sale started because I didn't know it was going to start, so yeah, fun. Oh. But yeah, I bought $100 worth. Anyway, moving on, I bought the Scimitar pack and the Armitage, and I played around with the Scimitar bit on my character. I'm going to stick with the Mogai because... The Scimitar feels more Riemann to me, because of course it was a Riemann ship, so I want to fly that on my Riemann character I'm rolling out. And plus, I just love the Mogai. I fell in love with that ship from the movie.
It's a good ship,
and it's
yeah.
a good ship in the game, so I feel like my Romulan's going to stick with that, and I'm going to put a Riemann into the Scimitar, but it's a fun ship to play around. A lot of cool stuff you can use with that. I haven't played around... I played around with the Armitage for, like, one mission, but I got to get it attuned to play up in that. But I from everybody I've heard, the Armitage is fun. I'm like, I want to fly a ship that shuttles out. That'd be cool. Shuttles are cool. Fighters are cool. So I want
to. So, in other words, you want to get used to carriers.
Yeah, I did fly the Vokuv, is it called, on the Cleon side, the first carrier. I hated it. It was so slow turning. That was just like, ugh. It was cool to launch Bird of Prey because that's what I launched. Cause like, oh, this is sweet. I can launch starships. But I hate the turn rate, and I had a terrible build probably because that guy wasn't around to build it for me, because I was pretty squishy in that carrier from what I remember. So. But I only flew it around in it for a week, and then I went back to the Bird of Prey, because that thing does some nasty damage. So, but this isn't a PvP show. This is a Foundry show. So why don't we get into review? Because while the Foundry is still broken, luckily, missions that are up are working now. So we have a mission that we recommend we play. And guess what? It's actually good, unlike the last one. What was the last one you recommended? I don't remember. It was probably good. I mean, we drew a lot of good. This is good.
You're just saying that to make me feel bad, even though it's not true.
It's not true. This is a pretty good mission. So let's get our goatees on, because we've got our interdimensional transporter ready, and we're going to go into the mirror universe. You shouldn't have shaved your Amish beard, because you were halfway there almost.
Yeah,
we would have been there. Oh, well.
And on to the review today. We're doing the Crossing Admiral Part 1 of 3. Now, this is a part 1 of a 3-part story arc, which is part of a 15-part series, mega series. And it is effectively all depicted in a, shall we say, a gory universe.
Yeah.
We'll name it that.
Yep. So.
Anyway.
So, yeah, you're going to be playing as your mirror universe self and all that stuff, so that's cool. I mean, we were mentioning that not long ago. We mentioned Mirror Wars, which was sort of the same thing. The I don't know if we might review it one day, we might not. But the basic gist was, the only complaint I really had about the series was the writing wasn't really, like, mirror universe-y. It didn't have that, like, style to it as much as you would. As I'd expect in a mission like this. We then pointed this series out, so we're going to be reviewing the Admiral, the first 3 parts of that whole big arc, and then you guys can feel free to check out the rest of the arcs, which we may go check out in the future episodes.
Yep. We'll be finishing off this 3-part series over the next couple of weeks.
Yep.
And then we'll probably visit the future parts over the course of 25, 30 episodes.
Yep.
It'll be a long time, because Well, I'm not joking when I say there's 15 missions in this, so it will take us a while. So we weren't prepared to do 15 straight missions and nothing but this.
Is this guy trying to compete with me in the Deep Space 11 missions? Because I made like 30 of those. If you're trying to compete with me, good luck, buddy. I'm just saying, good luck.
Anyway, as of this mission, as of this recording, it has 1,157 players. So it's got over 1,000 players, which is good.
Yep.
3.83 star rating, and it also happens to be the lowest star rated of all 15, the very bottom of it, which is also a very good sign, kind of. And it, really? Like I said, it's part one of a 3-part mini series, which is part of a massive multi-part. It's complicated.
Crazy. Yeah, it's crazy. But anyway, slip on your goatees, people, and your mirror universe outfits. Hell yeah, Hoshi, and take on the role of your mirror universe self on a mission into our universe, boring, and then take on a Terran Empire Admiral who has gone rogue. Wow. They do that a lot, don't they? First Archer
yes,
went
they
rogue.
Do.
These people are crazy in the Terran universe.
The Terry Empire.
The Terry, like the Terry Farrell Empire. I support that quite a bit. But anyway, the plot for this mission is a good starter one to get you started into this this whole mission series. It's huge. And it does a great job of setting up the next part of the series, obviously. You're definitely getting what's going to be the conflict in this next episode, what's going to be continuing from there, because it does a lot of setting up. This whole mission is basically a setup, so it's hard to review a plot and say, oh my god, it's the best thing ever, when really this is just part one of three of a huge, massive part. So you do have to look at this is just going to get you into the next parts of what you can expect from the rest of the series, with a few twists, hopefully, along the way. The characters are good. There's been some effort put into them. And they're key to telling a great multi-part series. Definitely characters really help it moving that along. Because let's look at the Breen series. There weren't really many characters to carry you through that. You had the Breen bad guy, thought Trell or something like that. But not many people know his name because he wasn't as memorable. Whereas with the Romulan series, which is regarded as the best one out of all of Cryptics, you've got Hakeev, which is memorable, and Obasek. And they carried you throughout that series, along with the amazing plot added into that. So hopefully, with this series, we'll get the same thing, where the characters will be expanded upon, and maybe even more will be added to that. You've played through the series, Wee-Wee, so far. Was that done, in a way, so far? Is this setting up the characters? Can you say anything without spoilers?
I'll put it this way. It's 15 parts for a very good reason.
Okay. So, Wee-Wee's not going to spoil it. Jerk. So the dialogue is well written in a style that feels appropriate to the Terran Empire characters, which I'm really happy with. Mirror Wars, it had a Mirror Universe feel to it in a way, but most of the dialogue didn't feel like it was from the Mirror Universe at times. This mission, right off the bat, I felt like I was a Terran captain in the Mirror Universe and stuff like that, by the way they talk, the way they act, stuff like that. Especially how, like, the admirals treat you. If you don't listen to me, I'll have you executed. Blah, blah, blah. Stuff like that. That's what I expect from Terran Empire dialogue and stuff like that. So, it does feel, though, that this would be best played on a human. Mm-hmm. Not an alien. So,
he's called the Terran
Empire. Yeah. Plus, the one guy you're dealing with, is against, like, aliens in general. He's like, Terran Empire for the Terrans! And you're dealing with him quite a bit, which it can be really awkward then if you're an alien and he's saying this stuff and you're working with this guy. And he kind of talks to you as if you're human, so it's... He probably wouldn't care if you're an alien, but still, he talks to you as if he's talking to a human who would agree with him that Terrans are the best, blah, blah, blah. So, I'd recommend play this on a human character if you've got it, but probably still work with an alien. Yeah. No canon contradictions with touchstoning on the Mirror Universe and its elements, so there's a lot there because, of course, the Mirror Universe was covered in three different Star Trek series. And there's some other, like, Stow elements into this series, like Sulu's in it. I'm just going to say that. A Mirror Universe Sulu. I thought this was Prime Universe Sulu.
Where's Sulu?
I don't know where he is. You'll have to play the mission to find out, but that was kind of fun. He did a really good job of recreating the NPC, too, because I know that is not in the Foundry. And I was like, oh, that's Sulu. He got it nailed down right. I don't know if the uniform's right, but it looked right. So,
but the uniform wouldn't be right, would it? Because it is
the Mirror Universe, yeah.
Yeah.
But it does look like Sulu, so that was a cool thing to see. And there's other stuff, too, but I don't want to go into them because they spoil the story. Even though it is just a setup, you still want some surprises. No spelling and grammar issues. Story received an 8.22 or 26th ranked in story. So a very good start to this series, in my opinion. Technical here. The maps were very good in this mission, especially the space maps. I don't know if you mentioned to me how great some of the maps get in this series. Did you say anything about that to me? I remember you said something. I think you just talked about story.
Well, some of the maps, depending on what they are, do actually really, really well. As far as detail and layouts and that kind of stuff. I mean, it depends what they are. I mean, there were some really, really good maps later down in the Mega Arc, which really put this the story arc justice on the technical side of things. But in this specific mission, I'd probably say the maps... to rephrase that, I'd probably say that he developed more technical skills as he went along the way.
Yeah, makes sense.
So, like, I mean, there's another very good reason why this is probably the bottom. It's supposed to be an intro. It's not supposed to be, too heavily story oriented. Just getting into it, and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So technical, it's not at its best here, but it does get you started on what you can expect.
I was blown away by that first map you warp into. It's like this giant space map at Terok Nor or whatever, Empognor, whatever they call it.
Terok Nor in that universe.
And then it's got like star bases everywhere. They just combine, so they're huge, and ships everywhere, stuff like that. And it's awesome. And you're just like, whoa! You're looking around already on the first map. So the ground maps are pre-made. Mostly, the one has a little bit of customization, though it's kind of weird. I looked around, like, some of it feels a little forced, but it's hard to do ground maps in the Foundry, so I don't knock them for not starting on a whole new map, because that is really difficult. I've tried it. It's tough. But space maps, definitely, I'm giving a thumbs up here. Great customization on those. Good transitions. I didn't notice any pointless maps, and there seemed to be plenty to do on each map. Did you notice anything, Wee Wee?
There might have been one or two instances where it just felt like too short of a journey through each map, but I put it this way: it's not exactly the most consistent thing in the world. Transitions they're generally good, but the transitions aren't actually consistent really. So don't expect like too much from that side of things.
I know you beam over to the Admiral's ready room on the ship for a little bit, and
you probably could have done it through
communications, but he did do some cool things over there, like some triggers and stuff, and there was a good deal of expose or whatever that went into the next mission. I used a big word there. I'm quite happy.
Yes.
But I'm gonna write that one down, hold on, with my Jupiter Force pen. Expose,
here it goes again, folks.
Oh man. But the author shows a good understanding of how the Foundry toolsets work through the creation of these maps and the use of triggers. There's some pretty cool trigger usage here between like explosions and beaming in different NPCs at different points. That stuff's cool too. So great use there. So he definitely shows that he has knowledge of the Foundry, and there's no issues there, so that's good to see. Great art asset usage to create new objects and customize pre-made maps. I will say again, it's cool, because most of the time you see with space maps, they're either just a planet, a star, that's it, or pre-made. But this one, he did a really nice job of making them look new. I don't know if he used any necessarily pre-made ones and just added more in. I think Bajor was one he used, but I don't know about the other one where you go into our universe for that. But
yeah,
they were still pretty cool to see. I had a wow moment on the first one, the first map for creativity, so that definitely helped there.
Yeah, all the different stations.
Yeah.
I mean, that's probably one of the best customized sort of like outposts I've seen. I mean, the entire area is littered with star bases and structures just on the first map alone. And that's surrounding Terok Nor.
Yep. That place is heavily fortified, so I don't see... And I thought about it, because I looked at it like, there's a lot here. Do they really need all this? Why is this all... And then I thought about it more. I'm like, oh, wait, the Terran Empire got their butts kicked, and that's where they had to operate out of for a while. Who knows how big their space is, so they might actually need all that.
That's probably the center of operations for all we know, rather than Earth.
We don't know how big their space is. It might just be as easy... It actually is, because they do get attacked by the Alliance as you leave. So it's easy for them to just do an attack on that system, apparently. So we don't know how tough they are, but they're definitely keeping a hold on that system. And you can tell by all that stuff he's put into that map. Good instructions for the mission stating where to go. I didn't notice that. I never seem to pay attention as much to the instructions as Wee Wee does. So, Wee Wee, did I wrong? Were they not good?
They were generally pretty good. He told you where to go, which is always a good sign. And generally, just...
Waypoints. I didn't get lost, so
that was there was a lot of waypoints. I didn't get lost. It was actually pretty good throughout the mission. Yeah, there was no problem with that.
It's pretty simple too. So it's not like you need advanced instructions in the dialogue. So. If you do anything, you're just pressing F or clicking a dialogue button. So or shooting things, because of course you got to shoot stuff in the mirror universe. Come on. No Foundry limitations then picked up. Did you? There was a little one I think you picked up on. Do you remember?
But it wasn't really a limitation, was it? Really, it was it was Cardassians and Klingons not being on the same team.
Oh, right, I remember talking about this.
Because, of course, the Klingon-Cardassian alliance in the other universe, you can't put Klingons and Cardassians on the same team in the Foundry. And so, like, he worked around it pretty well. I mean, he put a Cardassian mob after you'd killed the Klingon one. He reskinned one of the the frigate is another is a Galore, I think it was. Yeah.
It is squishy, but.
It's pretty squishy, but it worked around it pretty well. It's just a fine limitation which you couldn't avoid. So, hardly limitation really still present, nonetheless.
So then technical scored a 7.72, our 15th ranked in technical. So, all around it does seem like technical did pretty good here. There's no major issues there, so that's good to see. Alright, we're going to roll some dice here. I don't have a D20, I'm sorry. I don't know what's up with me in the D20 references. I think I did that last week. But anyway, we was going to talk about gameplay now and see if this is a fun mission to go pew-pew in.
Well, let's get into it, shall we? Space gameplay itself was a bit weak, unfortunately. We got the usual stuff in the mission, and actually that even that it's somewhat sparse, with barely any variety or consistency in this part of the mission at all. I'd say quite a bit of work needs doing for this part of the mission to make up against the rest, but there is limited room for improvement based on how the mission flows. So in other words, that there aren't really enough space maps to actually expand on to try and improve that part of the mission, but it does definitely need improving because generally it's kind of weak. Space combat, on the other hand, was pretty interesting. There's a variety of groups to fight, ranging from Klingons, Cardassians, as mentioned, and, of course, Terran mobs, which basically are feds. It's just literally just in the other universe, it's feds. It's basically copy-paste.
Yep.
Klingon mobs are relatively straightforward. That's like the first bad guy you ever face besides the Borg. But do a bit of damage to you, as is with Cardassians, so they should be relatively easy to fight. Terrans, pretty easy to clean up. Same as feds, should be no trouble at all. So the actual mobs themselves aren't that strong. Multi-stacking could have made up for that, but there's only one instance of it I noticed in the mission. I think that was towards the end.
Yeah, it was two weak squads.
It was two weak squads, and there were Terrans as well. And it was accompanied by several allied ships in that instance as well, which really didn't help, shall we say. I mean, you could have fought on, well, like two frigate groups off yourself if you had a good enough build and a good enough ship, which he didn't. And therefore...
You
really
gave me
made
that build.
That.
You just installed
your
own
build.
You
don't know how to use it, though.
You didn't say that. You said it was the build. I'm just calling you out.
There's a bit of room for improvement on this front, but space combat generally was much better than space gameplay, I'd say. Ground gameplay was interesting as well. Much more to do on this side of the front compared to space. Besides the usual stuff, there are several optional things to interact with, such as NPCs, torture, which was always fun as a Terran, and optional dialogue. But they are limited and not consistent throughout the mission.
Yeah, I don't remember much.
I'll mention that a little bit, but it's literally one or two instances, nothing of alternate dialogue, and the rest of it's nothing but straightforward, linear throughout the mission. So there's not exactly a choice in this, even though this has been updated. If you notice, though, in the dialogue boxes, it has a display name, which came in season 6. Yeah, so he updated it within the last year. But he didn't put alternate dialogue in.
One thing I would recommend if you're going to go and add in branching dialogue, do take consideration to not everybody's going to be human. So maybe sometimes where the Admiral might be insulting an alien race, have some options for if that person is an alien race, whether they talk back or just kind of take it, what would they do? Be a great way to explore those some more branching dialogue options.
There's nothing much beyond that, but it could use some work as well, like space, but unlike space, there is quite a bit of room for improvement. I mean, you spend a significant amount of time on the ground. So there is quite a bit of room for improvement, especially on the last couple of maps as well, which you'll find yourself in. Ground combat was mediocre, I'd say. Terran ground mobs are the only mobs you face on the ground, so no Klingons or Cardassians. You'd only face them in space. And they're the same as feds, so they should be pretty easy to overcome, unless you encounter a captain mob, in which case, good luck, because... You know, miniguns are pretty horrible in the hands of feds and Terrans.
I've noticed the mirror feds, their captain squads, are quite tough. And if you don't have a good build,
same as feds as well,
die.
They point a minigun at you, and you will die if you didn't kill them first, or if you dodge out the way or put some kind of heal on it. You will die if you go straight up against them. There's no multi-stacking, unfortunately, which could have easily made it a sense of one or two places, but didn't really happen. So, again, that kind of a thing. Multi-stacking really needs to improve generally in all through the mobs in this mission, I'd say. A bit of room for improvement on this front, much like space combat, and about the same level of improvement quality, I'd say. Of course, there was a sense of replayability. And, like I said, it's extremely limited. I mean, really limited. You're only scraping into the alternate dialogue section with this, because you ask a few questions to an NPC or two. And I think both of us were debating whether it was worth putting as alternate dialogue at all. because it's barely present in the mission.
It gets there just because it has it, but in personal opinion, if we don't listen to this score sheet at all, I wouldn't replay it unless the story gets a lot better here on out for more parts. And I just
Or if you want like a reference or something, because it's a 15-part story. Like,
yeah.
So you're going to want a reference back to this at some point.
But for gameplay purposes, if you're just skipping through the dialogue, no, there's not really a reason to replay this mission. I mean, there's just a little bit of combat and a little bit of other stuff to do that you might not have done on your first playthrough, but it's not really going to make up for that. So really, I see a lot of people just playing this once, unless for like a story reason they want to come back and play it again.
Mm-hmm. Overall, the gameplay's got a 6.08, which put it in 36th place. So pretty low down. Gameplay overall suffered quite a bit in this, and there's quite a lot of room for improvement. Less so in other subjects like space gameplay, but generally, I'd say it's pretty suffering in this mission.
I felt more interested because, one, it was a Mirror Universe episode, and I was more interested in the story, but for gameplay purposes, I was just kind of like, it's all right. It didn't bore me, but it wasn't, like, having fun.
Yeah.
But anyway, what do we think overall, Weeby?
It's a mission well worth checking out for those interested in playing as their Mirror Universe opposites or counterparts. It's a good start to a series that will hope to get better and better from this point on. And let me tell you, it does. It really, really does.
So how did you finish all of the missions at this point?
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to know. It's
15 parts and he hasn't finished it yet.
Jeez. This guy is going for my record. Not even... I don't think Revo beat it. I haven't checked to see how many Revo has up, but Revo didn't beat it. I gotta get back into author missions.
7.34 for this mission, which put it in 27th place. So, pretty middle-ish position.
Yeah, middle.
Yeah, so, generally okay. Good start to the series. Good intro. Will get a lot better as the series progresses. So, this to be at the bottom of the pile out of all of the missions to see.
What is this? It's not the Deep Space Nine effect, but it's the what do you call it? It's the effect where the first part kind of sets up the story and it just gets better.
I can't remember what I called it, but it's sort of like a multi-part effect or something. I forgot what I called
it. It's the something effect.
It's like an intro effect or something.
The mass
it's like
effect.
The introduction will always be pretty mediocre. It should always be fairly mediocre, just enough for you to get into the series, and then the rest of it until the end should really be really interesting, really gripping, and then at the end some kind of epic ending just to finish it off and make it worthwhile.
Sounds like Weeby's saying that this happens in the series based on what he's not telling us, so you people can expect.
Well, apart from the ending, that really is what happens, because the ending hasn't happened yet.
It hasn't happened. Hopefully, it doesn't have like the Mass Effect 3 ending where we just go, "What?" I don't think this author will do that, but I don't know. I just played one of his missions so far. We'll find out. But if you'd like your mission possibly reviewed on Foundry Files, email it to foundryfiles@gmail.com. If it's really good and we find it's good enough for the show, it will make it onto the show in a possible future episode. So you can check it out there. If you go over to jupiterforce.org, we have a Foundry Files section there where you can check out all our past episodes, which are also posted on YouTube. You can find us there. There's also the overall score sheet, the ranking table, I think we call it, where you can go check out all the last missions to see where they've all ranked. So that will be cool to see. Don't forget, Weeby has his request for you guys. Go ahead and remind him, Weeby.
It's a Klingon-Cardassian Alliance mission called Politics of the Mirror Universe, which kind of cheating on right now with this mission.
You're with this one, but...
That's not the point.
Yeah.
Anyway, but hopefully at some point, Armaker Fogg will join us for his epic, shall we say, moves.
Oh, yeah, you know what? Stick around after the credits, because for those... This isn't Foundry-related, but for those of you who do STFing, because I've got two characters right now I need to get the STF gear on. So we've been working on STFs quite a bit recently in Jupiter Force. And of course, if nobody does the ground STFs anymore, since Cryptic made it that you can just do the space ones. Especially Kerr Ground, because you all know how dumb that STF is, because the boss battle locks you in a room, decides to throw laser beams on top of you, chain lightning effects on you, assimilation on you, just hitting on everything, force field bubbles. It sounds ridiculous. Why did they design it with this many obstacles? So people stopped doing it. Well, don't threat.
They had it with this object in mind.
They fixed it with a specific object from the game that they've just added that you will see at the end of this. But thanks for watching, everybody. Oh, and quick plug before we go. I will be in Star Trek Las Vegas Con to say hi to people. and hang out with other Trek fans and see Star Trek guests during the whole Star Trek Las Vegas weekend. We can't go because they kicked him out of this country, apparently.
I'm on the other side of the planet, so
yeah,
it's difficult.
And it's kind of hard to get into America for whatever reason, you know, they're whatever. But I'll be down there, and we're possibly seeing to doing a Foundry Files live from there. Hopefully, we will be able to join us for that. We'll see. We have to work out all that stuff. But you can look forward to that. But again, thank you for everybody for watching, and I will leave you with one of Wee Wee's famous quotes of the day.
I hear Gavin's.
Hello, ladies. I'm Admiral Murphy, and that's Wee Wee, and he's really pissed off at Gebbins right now. He'll tell you why.
Because he's standing in the middle of space with a spacesuit yeah. and a claw next yeah. to an asteroid.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What an ass. Yeah. How does it make you feel inside?
Words cannot describe the rage.
Yeah. I feel like a novel's needed for this. And that's an audio test here at Foundry Files.
Yes, it is. Now the record starting, it's all going to fall apart.
Yep.
I might equip the flamethrower to see if I can disrupt its attacks as well.
Alright, nobody swear. No, I'm just kidding.
Is bitch a curse word?
Is bitch a curse
no.
word?
No, fucking is.
You know what? Yes.
What?
I believe it is.
Okay, no, it is.
They're alive.
I got a giant flamethrower.
I got a flamethrower too.
Ruffy, hurry up.
Excuse me for hitting the record button.
We realize you keep pushing the R button to keep your auto running.
I might have killed my playmate, Murphy.
No, I didn't realize that. Hey, watch it.
What?
Don't throw it.
Where the hell did you get that? I want that.
It's
Tier 5 Romulan.
I haven't seen that. Alright, we got their disco balls ready.
Yep.
Alright, Captain Planet's gonna be pissed, but
Alright, let's try this. Here we go.
One, two, three, go.
Some poo came out.
Hey, dude, wake up.
Yeah.
Is he gonna dance?
I don't know. We're gonna see. He's gonna move first. Oh god!
He's not dancing.
Yeah, he is.
There we go. Shoot him! Oh my god, is this working? Oh my god! Just avoid the orb. Get another one ready.
Yeah! Oh, you don't give a crap no more.
Everybody spread out a bit, because he's gonna he might just disrupt the light.
Yeah.
Holy shit!
This is awesome.
We are doing pure ground now all the time.
We're actually beating him.
Sorry.
That's
a strategy.
Wind ribbons all around.
Okay. I'm getting this video published as soon as I can.
Someone quickly remind me.
Remind me.
That is awesome.
We're beating
six processors down here.
We found probably the best exploit I've ever seen in this game.